So what's getting a lot of attention lately are PARP inhibitors. So long story short, these oral drugs, there's a couple now approved in castrate-resistant prostate cancer that go after genetic mutations. Do you want to just talk a little bit about them in any direction you want to go in? Because it's now a new option out yep. there for some patients, these pills that exploit the fact that either your tumor has some genetic mutation or even when you do a test, maybe you were born with one of these things. So I thought you could give your little take on it because it's a hot topic.
Yeah, and it should be a hot topic. The only thing is, it's not a topic that necessarily will impact most patients with prostate cancer because the kind of genetic findings that are usually required for successful treatment with these PARP inhibitors are few and far between, meaning that maybe in between 10 and 25% of men may have these at any point in the course of their disease. So the PARP inhibitors, at least right now, not going to be for 100% of patients. But I think the important thing to know is, how are you going to know unless you test?
Yes.
Because if you find this, you know, any of the genetic abnormalities, and really the ones that we're finding where PARP inhibitors are most effective is in the BRCA1, BRCA2 mutations, whether those happen in the tumor and or, you know, in the body that you inherited. So, you know, it's really important for anybody with metastatic disease to have some testing done on that. And we're even in the NCCN is suggesting patients who had high risk localized disease. And I advocated for men with biochemical relapse because, frankly, if you have biochemical relapse, you are already high risk, right? You've already relapsed. I don't think the NCCN put that in there, but I mean, I do it in, I know, I do it in.
No, I think that's awesome.
Chemical relapse. I mean, so, but I mean, the testing there, the testing that can be done very easily is germline testing. So they can take blood. They oftentimes use saliva. It's not all that costly. And, you know, you can get that anytime and it's no big deal.
Yes.
It is a big deal, however, if you are found to have one of those mutations that's related to familial cancers, that you be seen by a genetic counselor and advised about how your family members should be tested or not and so forth, and what implications it might have for them. But, you know, the other kind of testing we do that's a little more challenging is tumor testing. You know, so we take a piece of the tumor from wherever. Oftentimes it's, you know, from somewhere, you know, a lymph node, for example. I mean, bone we can do, but it's harder to get a good quality sample. But we can also look in some circulating DNA that's from the tumor in the bloodstream. So there's these different ways of testing. Again, for some of these mutations. Now, when we look at the tumor, we're not only looking at these, you know, BRCA1, 2 type mutations where PARP inhibitors are useful, but also some other mutations where other drugs may actually target that in the tumor tissue. So there's, you know, two types of therapy options that you might have by doing that testing. So the bottom line is, we, you know, this genetic testing is here to stay, and there's a lot more we need to learn about it. But it's here to stay, and it's an important thing that I think patients should definitely take some time to learn about that.
Yeah, because you're calling for it potentially to be utilized earlier when someone fails therapy early on.
Well, yeah, because, you know, the thing is, if we know, first of all, if a guy has high risk disease, I mean, it may signal that there's something in the family And it's really important for us to address that with family members. It also tells us, well, down the line, we might need to use a PARP inhibitor on this person.
Yes.
But we already know that, even before he gets metastatic, because we already have that piece of data. So anyway, I like to do it that way. And I try to do it that way in all my patients.
I mean, that makes a lot of sense in my mind, because you remember it was just a couple of years ago, let's test everybody that has advanced disease. Oh, that might be aggressive. And now you're supposed to do that. And now if someone fails curative therapy, there's a reason. And so it'd be nice to know. And it'd be nice to know for the patient as well as the family. Maybe there's something running through the family. So I bet you if we do this interview in a year or two, they're going to be calling for that universally. It's just going to take a year or two to get there.
Yep, I agree with you. I think so.